in Northland. Let's stand together. Sing this. Let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you.
That's a great way to start, huh? You can go ahead and have a seat just for a moment. Welcome to Northland. It is so good to have you here in this room, and also those of you who are gathered with us online, both in our house churches and small groups, as well as in the correctional facilities that we are so privileged to have you join us, being a great thing called technology, but even a far more beautiful thing because of the Spirit of God who unites us. So it's great to see all of you here. If you're brand new at Northland, I want to encourage you to find somebody with an orange lanyard, either in your section or out in the foyer area, and you can talk to them about how to get involved. We actually today, right as I'm speaking, we have a Belong and Grow a journey that's beginning, and we do those regularly. It's for folks to kind of get into the stream that's called Northland and to find out what life here looks like, what ministry here looks like, what our vision's like, and they're meeting over in the hub, and you can find out more about that and sign up for the next one coming down the road. But also out in the foyer, you've noticed there are some festivities going on over there. A little poster that says, "Welcome to the Hall family." Marshall Hall and his wife, Lori, are some people that we are so excited to say they're finally here. Many of you remember back in the spring, we were talking with Marsh. I remember my first conversation with him on a Zoom call and just seeing his connect predominantly with Jesus, his connect for worship, his engagement with our vision and this story called Northland, and was here in June, and they were praying through this whole season of their life, and we were talking together about him becoming our next worship pastor. And in July, we announced it, started at the end of August, but they've been moving as a family, had a little thing called a hurricane interfere with the schedule a little bit, and Lori and the girls had to head back up. So this is the first weekend that they've been all able to be here. They sold their house in Chicago. He was a pastor at Willow Creek Church, one of their worship pastors up in Chicago. Sold their house up there, purchased a house here, moving truck came this week. They've opened their boxes, and we said, we would love to tell you hello. I think you would like to say welcome to Marsh and Lori Hall and their girls. You guys coming up. So these guys, this is Reese and this is Presley. Presley just turned 13 years old just a couple weeks ago. Okay, so Reese, what's it like having a 13-year-old in the house? A teenager for an older sister. What's up with that?
It's cool, but it's kind of weird because sometimes I go into her room and she says, "Reese, please, please get out. I really need some privacy right now." And I just don't need to.
So is being a teenager kind of cracking up to all you thought it would be so far?
I mean, it's really not any different than being 12, except that, you know, people make fun of you for being a teenager.
All right, well, we'll make sure and celebrate that. And then this is Selah, who's 2 years old, and it's really good to see you. Thank you so much for the wave. Oh, Ed. I will not say, I won't say how old you are, Lori, but I will
We're
so excited to have you guys here. Tell me, what's it like? You finally are all in one place again.
Ah, yes, we are. And that feels like a big exhale for me as wife and mom. Many of you have moved and uprooted your family, so you know that it can be disruptive and challenging. So it was really important for us, of course, to know that this was God's idea and not just ours. So we've been praying about this transition for many months and processing with friends and each other and getting to know the team here at Northland, and together began to trust that God in his kindness was uprooting this family with intentions of replanting us here with you folks at Northland. So then something that's disruptive and challenging can also be adventuresome and faith building. So we're glad to watch him answer our prayers and are still trusting him to answer more prayers, especially those for deep roots. Yeah. Deep roots in our neighborhood, deep roots as we get to know you folks here at Northland, and together deep roots as we put our trust in the unfailing love of God. Together.
So, Selah can say hello if she would like.
You want to talk?
No.
Okay. But would you like to talk?
Sure.
So, how can we be praying for you guys as a family?
Like my wife said, moving has its challenges. I guess the biggest one is the whole part of moving where you move and leave where you were and go somewhere else. We're in the midst of some unsettledness, just figuring out life again. And I guess I would pray for that because we do want to grow deep roots here. Yeah, would you pray for a settledness and a rest? A rest, because we are, well said, tired. So we could use some supernatural renewal. So pray for that, please.
Absolutely, we'll do that. And you guys kind of had some surprises this week, too. You're opening some boxes that you hadn't opened for years. It's kind of like Christmas all over again.
It's a little like Christmas and a little like, oh my gosh.
Why do we keep this
stuff? Yeah. So Reese, I wanted to ask you, we were talking last night, what's the meaning of the universe? I said, what are some questions I can ask? And I asked you, and I joked, why don't I ask you what the meaning of the universe is? She said, okay, what's the meaning of the universe?
You look it up on Google, it's 42.
Here we go. So, all right, outside, we asked the halls, we said, okay, what are some of your favorite snacks and treats? And so when you go out for a sugar high afterwards, every one of them was requested by a particular member of this family. Albanese gummy bears, Sour Patch Kids, red velvet cupcakes, carrot cake cupcakes, brownies, chocolate chip cookies, blue raspberry Airheads, Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, and M&Ms. How are you guys so skinny? Wow. So you can guess, you can ask each of them afterwards, who do you think requested the Reese's Peanut Butter Cups? Not Reese. Marsh did. That's your deal. He's a Reese's Peanut Butter guy. You love him. So what we want to do is have some time of prayer for them. I'm going to ask our leaders, our volunteers, staff, spouses, if you would, let's gather around as a leadership community. Come on up to the podium, and we'll pray over these guys. While they're coming, I want you to take a look at a video that our amazing video team put together this week to introduce us to the halls. And so take a watch while our leadership gathers around.
I was born in Lexington, Kentucky. Same house all my life from birth until I flew the coop. My dad fixed printing presses. He was also a pastor. So I grew up a PK, like a printer's kid and a pastor's kid. Mom played piano. My dad was an awesome singer, so there were lots of times around the piano where mom and dad were singing, and at some point, I jumped in on that. I spent the majority of my life doing music. One thing most folks don't know about me is that in the fourth grade, I won the crab walk competition at our elementary school. I wasn't much of a sports guy, so I'm still holding on to that. I've just come from Willow Creek for the past 5 years, but it was our second stint. Actually, back in 1999 and 2000 was the first time I was there. And when I was talking to a friend of mine in the hallway, there was this person that walked by, this young lady. And I did one of those things you do when you're in your 20s. You just... And I turned back around, and my friend Camille said, that's Lori Vick. And so ever since that moment, Lori's been on my mind. She's so courageous just in life. Like, she shines in critical moments. She shines in crises. But she really is so brave and courageous with her faith. Presley just turned 13 years old. She is a leader. Reese is my 11-year-old, and Reese might be the funniest person I know. And Sela is our 2-year-old, and she was unexpected and is absolutely magic. My goal is to create an atmosphere where someone can experience God. Northland has been blessed to have been and still is a thriving community. But I think the coolest thing that I've seen in folks is that as much as folks are excited about the legacy, they're holding on to it with open hands and saying, we love where we've been. God, will you take us where you want us to go? And I can't be more on board with that.
I love that. So, hey, Reese, would you open that? It's a gift for your dad that I wanted him to have, but you can go ahead. You guys are really good at opening presents, so I thought I'd let you do that. There we go. So, what this is in Orlando, sometimes people think it's the wand of the fairy godmother. That's not what this is. It's a conductor's baton. And I want you to have it, and Mars, put it somewhere visible to remind you of God's calling on your life and your calling here in this community. You're a conductor. A conductor in an orchestra is not someone that is playing an instrument. Usually they are just serving the rest of the orchestra and the vocalists and whoever the choir is and so forth. I give you this baton to do that with us. But the difference between a typical orchestra is the only audience is an audience of one. You guys aren't the audience. He's conducting all of us, not just the folks that are up front. We have an amazing worship team, but they're not our performers. They are our companions in ministry. We're told in Peter that we're a chosen people. We're a royal priesthood. We're a holy nation. We're people belonging to God. And we've been brought together to declare the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into light and out of death into life. And I want to thank you. And I want to thank you, as well as these young ladies, to say thank you for coming alongside and trusting God with this. And we want to lift him up to you. I'm so grateful, Marsh, for your heart for worship. And you've got a heart for worship, not because you love music, even though you do. You've got a heart for music because you love Jesus. And you want to lead us to that. And so we want to pray for that. Just some brief prayers from a lot of this worship team and some of our leaders. Sean's going to pray, and then Michelle, and then John, and then Arlene, and then Sydney, and then we're going to commission you as a people. So guys, would you please all stand? It's all of us together standing in the presence of this audience of one who, along with this leadership team, is going to lead us and to equip us and to call us to a very intentional task. Sean, lead us.
Let's pray. Father, I just know that when you look down right now on the Hall family, you have enormous joy and pride as your family, this family, radiates so much love and joy and pride in each other. I just have loved watching them love each other, smile at each other, hold each other up. God, would you continue that? Would you increase that in their lives? I thank you not only for Marsh and for Lori, but God, thank you for these awesome kids, for Presley and Reese and Sela. We need them here. Their leadership, we cannot wait to see what you continue to do in the next generation. So thank you for bringing them here for just this time. It's perfect timing, God. Thank you so much.
Jesus, in the video piece, Marsh mentioned the rich legacy of worship here at Northland. But I want to thank you for the rich legacy that Marsh and Lori bring to us. Not only are they incredibly talented, but they love worship, they love you, and most of all, they love people really, really well. On a personal note, I'm in awe of the plan that you have, that you would bring this man that I've known for about 20 years or so to come alongside us at just a time as this, and to lead this team and to lead this church to your throne every week.
Father, we thank you for your generosity as you give beautiful gifts to your body. Thank you for bringing this beautiful family. We pray that you would just roll out the red carpet for them. Mm-hmm. Father, we pray that you would give them some rest of their souls as they settle in. And Father, that as their roots grow deep, that you will nourish them through the relationships that you will bring to them. In Jesus' name.
Lord God, I thank you for this family as well. And I want to pray specifically for Lori and for Presley and for Reese and for Selah. Lord, I pray your hand of protection over them. Guard their hearts. Cover them with your grace. And Lord, I pray that you would allow those deep roots to grow into you. And Lord, that their lives would be fruitful and abundant because they've planted themselves deeply in you.
Lord, we're so thankful for the fact that you never stop moving, Lord, that you're always moving and always working, and that you've moved in such a way that has brought the halls here, Lord. I pray that you would be with them as they're getting accustomed to their new house and living in Florida, Lord. Provide them with the supernatural rest they need, Lord. Be with Marsh and Lori as they raise three daughters, Lord. Help them to always point their daughters towards you, to teach them to be lovers of you and of your word, Lord, and leaders for your church, Lord. And above all else, help all five of them to just always keep their eyes fixed on you, God.
And so, Father, we thank you. Thank you for the calling that's on Reese, that's on Presley, and even Selah. And, of course, Lori and Marsh. And we ask that you would bless them and keep them. Keep them close. May he lead us out of the overflow of his love for you. May he relish grace, savor the life of the gospel, the redemption, the restoration, that good news, and may it overflow in how he leads us. And as you're causing your face to shine on him, be gracious to him. Lift up the light of your countenance on him and give him shalom. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. And all the people said, amen. Amen, guys. Thank you. So, and Selah made it. She made it through. There is, mom was not, you didn't have a doubt, did you? You didn't have a doubt. So, obviously, these guys are going to be out front here, and just an amazing leadership team. While they're heading down, why don't you find out who else you're worshiping with? Let's connect together and then dive into worship, and let's just do it.
Heaven comes to fight for me. Sing. give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
Jesus, look full. His wonderful face and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Let's sing that again.
Oh, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face and the things.
Go to God this morning, church. How we turn our eyes to You. How we look to You. We fix our eyes on You, the author and the finisher of our faith. Help us not look from side to side. But daily, every morning, look to You. Daily, every morning, see You seated on Your throne, high and lifted up, in Your rightful place. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim, so the hymnist says. The more we fix our eyes on You, fear will grow strangely dim in the light of Your glory and grace. Shame will grow strangely dim in the light of Your glory and grace. Help us to fix our eyes on You, the author and the finisher of our faith. We thank You for being with us, and we thank You for this morning and the opportunity to lift You up. God, lead us today to speak to us. We are listening. And the church said, amen, church. You may be seated.
Wow, what a start. So looking forward to this journey with Marsh and the entire team. We have an amazing, amazing blessing to have these guys with us. Absolutely. Just as I look up and all of those individual members of that team, they really do make an orchestra that accompanies us as we together before this audience of one. Well, if you're just joining us, let you know where we are in this journey that we're on at the beginning of this fall. If you've been with us for a while, I'll remind you, we're in a series that we're calling Calibrate. Calibrate is when I reorient my life according to what is really important and what I most need. Ancient ships would calibrate their compasses going into a quiet harbor and saying, where is magnetic north? Now, the place where we calibrate is at the feet of Jesus. It's what He calls us to do. It's who He calls us to be as His people. If you've got your Bible, turn to Luke chapter 10. This is the passage that's been leading us through this series, and we've got about three more weeks after this. Luke chapter 10, verse 38. As Jesus and His disciples were on their way, He came to a village. Now, this village we know from other sources in the New Testament is a place called Bethany. It's just east of Jerusalem. And that's where a woman named Martha opened her home to Him. So she's having a dinner party, basically. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what He said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and she asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." Now, Mary is expecting, or Martha is expecting Jesus to side with her. Well, sure, he's going to tell Mary to get up and to get busy. He surprises her with a firm, gentle rebuke, but it's a firm one. "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered. All right, we're going to repeat that, but instead of saying the word Martha, I want you to say your name out loud twice. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Matt, Matt. Let's try it one more time. Everybody, hear your name spoken out loud. Ready? Go. Matt, Matt. The Lord answered, "You're worried and you're upset by many things." And then he clarifies, he says, "But few things are needed, or indeed only one." So Mary has chosen what's better, and it will not be taken away from her. He says, Mary is doing what I want her to be doing. She's calibrating right now. Getting reoriented to what her ultimate identity is and calling. What's calibrating look like? It's 5 minutes or 50 minutes or 5 hours. Depends on the day. In which we get to at the feet of Jesus in stillness. And these are some of the disciplines of calibration. Stillness, where we get off the treadmill for a while and get still at the feet of Jesus and we submit. She's at his feet. She's submitting before his lordship. And that will involve all of who I am, and that will lead me to surrendering in a sense of, with a sense of stewardship, my time, my abilities, my finances. It's all his. And we'll be silent about where he wants us to direct our time and abilities and finances. And that silence is not just emptying our minds of everything and achieving nothingness. It's being silent in order to listen to his word, listen to scripture. And in the midst of all of that, I need to refine a cadence in my life of sacrificial choices. Every one of us every day makes a choice. For every yes in my life, there's a no. Whatever I said yes to this morning, I said no to something else. And what Jesus is doing is an affirming Mary for saying yes to sitting at his feet and saying no to all the other distractions. Today we're coming to single-mindedness being part of the deal. Go back to verse 42. Jesus said, Mary has chosen, there are lots of things you could be focusing on, but really few things are needed, or indeed only one, and Mary has chosen what is better. Now, if you go into a nursery or a playroom with a bunch of toddlers with tons of toys, what are the things that you notice right away is there's not a whole lot of single-mindedness? You ever notice that with little kids? I mean, it's really fun to watch them play because they'll be, if there's lots of toys, wow, this is pretty cool. And then all of a sudden somebody might grab it or catches their eye and they're on to the next one. And they're saying, man, this is great. And this is, oh, wait a minute, what is that? And then they'll start, you know, there's a running bet, I think, right now. There's a pool back in the worship team. Can I fit in this? But we won't know. But so you'll be doing that. And then all of a sudden, oh, my goodness, a chickie or a duck or whatever that is. I'll go back to this one. Oh, I forgot about this. That's really fun. Oh, what's this over here? Constant movement. The older kids get, the more they learn to focus. So it's really funny and fun to see little children with a lack of single-mindedness and floating from one thing to another, to flitting from here, flirting to there. It's not as funny when adults do it. And we all do it. We all start worrying and getting upset about so many things. And Jesus says, there's only one thing. It's only one. Last night we were with the Halls and some friends having dinner. Came to the topic of favorite movies. And, you know, as I go back, I don't know that it's one of my favorite movies, but it's certainly a memorable one. You guys remember long ago, City Slickers? Remember that one? And you got these two guys going to a dude ranch. Billy Crystal's one of the characters, and they meet this old guy, Jack Palance, his character, and he scares them to death, and he is asked, what's the secret to life? And he says, you know what the secret to life is? Remember, he holds up that old gnarly I think it looked like about 135-year-old hand, and he says, one thing. And Billy Crystal said, that's the secret. He says, yep, it's one thing. He says, well, what's the one thing? And he said, that's for you to figure out. There's an aspect of maturity where we come to one thing, but that's not where maturity starts, really. We've got to make sure the one thing is the right thing, that the one thing is the thing. Our vision is engaging people to be fully alive in Jesus. And being fully alive in Jesus involves a regular cadence of calibrating at his feet. Now, you guys remember the ABCs of being fully alive? What's fully alive look like? Huh? Awe, A, B, C, D, E, awe, brokenness, creativity, depth, engagement, fellowship, generosity, heart. But what's I? Intimacy. Intimacy with Jesus. That's the essence of the life of the gospel. I was dead, dead to God, dead to his heart, dead to relationship. He forgave my sin by his work on the cross, calls me back into a relationship. And that call is one of intimacy. John 17:3, Jesus says, the essence of eternal life. So eternal life is not a synonym for heaven. We'll experience eternal life in heaven. But eternal life is being united with the Father. This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you sent. Intimacy. That's what Mary is doing. Lots of things every day of our lives want to distract us. And Jesus says, you know, a lot of those things, some might be good, some might be downright sinful, and you got to put those to the side. But even the good stuff, it's got to fall into the background before this one thing. Learning to relate with Jesus in my board meetings, in my recreation, in my family time, in my alone time. And constantly coming back and calibrating, how am I living my life, and am I living in deference to, in accordance with, this ultimate relationship of intimacy with him? That will require single-mindedness, not just daily, but hourly. Now, the best commentary on Scripture, you've heard me say before, is other Scripture. So in Psalm 27, verse 4, David gives the Old Testament version of this story of Mary and Martha. And in Psalm 27, verse 4, he says this, one thing I ask from the Lord. How many things? One thing. This only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. He says, in the midst of all that's going on, there's one thing above all else that I'm after. And you know, we hear that. We've got our to-do lists, our clients, our family, our stresses, our medical bills. We've got all this stuff swirling around. And we say, wouldn't that be nice? You know, I know David. He's got this monastery life. He's off to the side. Let me tell you what the context is. David is not on some beach in the Caribbean fulfilling another contract for his publisher to do another hit song. He's not writing this psalm for that. He's in the middle. I've got a lot going on in my life, and part of this series is for me to calibrate. People say, why'd you pick this series? I said, I needed it. For me to calibrate, because I get worried and distracted by so many things, and really only one thing is ultimately needed. And it happens in the midst of all the stuff. It's not waiting for it all to get set. You know what the context is? David is being pursued by Saul's army, and they're out to not affirm him, but kill him. He's running for his life. Look at the context. Verse 1, Psalm 27. He says, the Lord is my light, and he's my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, he might be holed up in a cave when he's writing this, with Saul's army around him. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident Now you hear the verse in its context. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek. All right, if I'm David, I got an army besieging me, and I've got one thing I'm going to ask from the Lord. What do I want to ask? God, would you get rid of the army? Would you give me more ammo? Would you do this, that? In the midst of all this other stuff swirling around, he says, one thing I ask of the Lord. Go back to a verse that I ask of the Lord. This only do I seek. No, go back to verse 4. That was my fault. This only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple. That is what I ultimately need. David's doing what Mary was doing. What Mary was doing is what Jesus says we all need to do. Calibrate at my feet. But what about that? Yeah, I get that. We'll deal with it. But what about, yeah? What? Relate with me. Make a single-minded, sacrificial choice. So what will that look like? Let me give you four expressions. Let's go back through verse 4 of Psalm 27. First expression, it will involve direction on a daily basis. One thing. What's your one thing? What's mine? What's my one thing? Every person has a one thing at any given moment. You've got one thing right now. Jesus says to Martha, he says, Mary, she's chosen what's better. Am I choosing what's better? Am I making a sacrificial choice to display a cadence of single-mindedness in the midst of all of these other distractions? To say, you know what? This really is something that's attractive. This is something that's haunting me. This is something that's worrying me. This is something that's overwhelming me. But I'm going to choose one thing. Okay. Our campus is on Dog Track Road. Why is it called Dog Track Road? Because there's a dog track. And years ago, I remember reading about a dog track in Florida. I don't think it was this one, but it was somewhere in Florida. We're in the middle of a race, so the dogs are running around the track and they're chasing a mechanical rabbit. I didn't even know that. They chase after mechanical rabbits. It's a little artificial rabbit that's supposedly taken off and going around the track. They had an electrical situation happen, and the rabbit had a short out and exploded. So it was just burnt fur and smoking, and it stopped right there. And they said, what was phenomenal is these, hey, the dogs didn't know a rabbit could explode. And then when it did, they all stopped. Some stopped and went over to sniff the burnt fur. Others turned around, started howling at the crowd. Some others just laid down in the track. A few others headed back to where they came from. What was the problem? They all lost their one thing. We need one thing. What's your one thing? What's mine? Where do I go for significance? Where do I go for a sense of security? Where do I go for stress relief? Where do I go for self-esteem? Do we chase after maybe popularity or possessions? Maybe it's power we think will do it for us. Or pleasure. Jesus says, this is the one thing that you need. So every morning waking up saying, I've got a direction here. It doesn't mean I don't deal with other things, the sin I need to put aside, the other things, there might be some good things. But bottom line, so Matthew chapter 6, verse 31, Jesus says, here's what you do. You've got to choose your one thing, which is me, my kingdom, my righteousness. Seek first. My kingdom. Now he says, let me tell you what the pagans do. Now Jesus is not using that in a derogatory sense. He's just saying that those that don't know the name of God, they worry. We get worried and upset and distracted. And there's all this stuff. He says, let me tell you something. Don't worry saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things. You know what? Their tendency is to put that down and run after this, run after that. He says, you know what? Your Heavenly Father knows. He knows what you need. But seek first his kingdom. The kingdom of God is not a place, it's the realm of his rule. It's the realm of his authority. Seek first to submit before him and his righteousness. Righteousness, not just a moral code, it's rightness with God. I'm forgiven and given positional right standing before him. My sins forgiven, but then I need to learn to live righteously, to live according to the symphony of his commands and his love and his grace. And you know what? Once I'm doing that, relating with him in intimacy, all these other things, the ones that are needed, they'll be added. Pick your direction. Name your one thing and make sure it's the right thing. And go back to the text. The second thing that we need to choose, second really expression of single-mindedness, after the direction comes a dependence. He says, one thing I ask from the Lord. You can tell a lot about your own journey or another person by what they pray for. And there are plenty of times my prayer has to do with this thing and that thing and that thing. Instead of, I want you. I want closeness with you in the midst of all of this stuff. Dependence. He takes the first step in this dance. But I say, Jesus, I need you. Hosea chapter 10, verse 12, we looked at this in our submission weekend. Sow for yourselves righteousness. This calling that you've got, let the seeds of the gospel go deep into the soil of your heart. Sow for yourselves righteousness. Reap the fruit of his unfailing love. I don't have to earn my way to this. He's invited me because of the cross, because of his forgiveness. He says, my love's going to be unfailing. Then, break up your unplowed ground. There's hard, crusty soil, remember we talked about, that's resistant to seed. So what does it sound like? What does the invitation sound like when Jesus says, I want intimacy with you. I want intimacy with you. I want relationship with you. What's that invitation? The seeds of that invitation, what's it sound like? You know what seed sounds like when you throw it on concrete or throw it on hard pan? It's clatter. It just is resistant. What he's saying in this text is break up that unplowed ground and let the seeds of that invitation fall on soft, soft soil that's plowed, that's ready. It's humility. It's me saying, I'm not resistant to you. I need you. I need you. It's humility. James chapter 4, verse 6, God gives more and more grace. But you know what? I'm not going to experience it until I humble myself. God's opposed to the proud. When people say, you know what, I don't need you, God. I need to do all these other things. That's that dry soil and the seed clatters. But when we say, I need you, I am desperate for you, I'm humble. To be humble is just to be honest. It's not some, hey, I don't have to play some mind trick. To be humble is to say, Jesus, I got nowhere else to go. This will not address the deepest yearnings of my soul, nor will solving this. Ultimately, I need you. I'm going to ask Marsh to come out and sing over us a hymn that you've heard here before. It's an ancient spiritual, an old spiritual from, goodness, 100, 150 years ago, I think, called Give Me Jesus. What are you dealing with right now? You know what you're in my ultimate need is? Jesus says, we'll deal. All these other things will be added to you, but right now, you need me. You need a closeness with me. Friendship with me. Now we'll do here in a few months, probably after the holiday, sometime in the winter, a series on worship. One of the things we'll talk about is worship both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Hebrew word for worship, the Greek word for worship, have to do with bodily posture that manifests itself into the cadence of my journey. Bowing, lifting hands, kneeling. One of the things we do here some is open palms. I'd like you to just open your palms right where you are. You know what you got going. Maybe it's a financial thing. Maybe it's some stress over the job. Maybe it's a relational issue. I don't know what it is. Jesus said, whatever it is in the midst of that, and David models it, ask him. Make a request now. Our prayer lives are directly related to our humility, and our humility is directly related to how honest we are about what we ultimately need. So as Marcia's singing, take these words, let them become your own. And just say, whatever I'm dealing with, give me Jesus.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. And when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, oh, and when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. But give me
a powerful moment in a human being's life when we say, all of this is there, but you know what? Above all, give me Jesus. But we're not done with the single-mindedness at that point. We then need to layer on top of that direction and that dependence a diligence, an intensity, a passion. Now, that diligence is directly related to our desperation and our direction. I'm not going to be diligent about something that I don't sense I need. I'm not going to pursue what I don't prefer. And a lot of people, times, we're not passionately pursuing intimacy with Jesus because we're not yet convinced these other things won't satisfy us. But David says, one thing I ask from the Lord, and that only shall I seek. So it's not just, okay, I got it. No, there's an action word. This only do I seek, that I may dwell. The word dwell there is a permanent word. It's not, I'm not just going to dabble. I'm dwelling. I am here. I am here in the midst of whatever comes. There's a permanence there, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord on Sundays when there's no ball game on TV. No. All the days of my life. And you guys know what the Hebrew word for all there is. It means all. Every day. Happy days, sad days, challenging days, calm days. All the days of my life. Being diligent. And a lot of times we're not convinced that this is really ultimately what's going to do it. We think that along with a bunch of these other things. And as a result, we're not diligent enough. I'm not referring to working our way to Jesus. He's taken the first step in the dance, but it's me embracing ultimately my need. I love the story of the guy that took a pilgrimage to the desert, a business guy who was wanting to get right with God, and he was told about some hermit that lived up in the mountains, a spiritual guru kind of guy. He finally found him. Just talking to him, telling him what he ultimately wanted. I want a relationship with God, and I also want to be baptized. Do you baptize people? And this guy said, yeah, I'll baptize you. And he says, come with me. And they walked a little ways to a little oasis, a pool. And he says, and the guy said, you got to be kidding me. This is actually going to happen. He's all excited. And he gets in the water, and the old man comes down, stands next to him, says some of the right things, and then puts him under. And he goes down. And now, while he's under the water, he's just kind of entering into the moment. Now, whether you're a Baptist or not, every one of us has an internal clock as to how long a baptism should last, you know? There's just a particular moment when you think, okay, I think that was good. I'm done. And that guy had that moment. He's ready to come up. So, but the guy's not, he's not bringing him up. So he says, okay, I need to take all this in a little bit more. I think he's wanting me to make sure I'm getting it. So, but now he's getting a little uncomfortable, and so he goes to rise back up, and to his shock, he feels pressure from the old man keeping him under the water. He's thinking, okay, maybe he really wants me to get this. I'm gonna enter into this. And after a few moments, he's forgotten about all the spiritual stuff. He just is interested in one thing, and that is something that he doesn't have at that moment, and it's air. And so he starts to come back up, and to his shock, the old man puts both hands and all his weight on him to keep him under the water. And he starts not caring a whole lot about this frail man. He just wants to get rid of that man so he can get through the water. And he is shocked at how strong the dude is. And there's this tussle back and forth, and he is flailing now. He starts starting to see stars, and his lungs are burning, and just when he thinks he's about to pass out, he makes one final lunge at the guy, and the old man backs away, and this guy bursts through the surface of the water, inhales what he had before taken advantage of, kind of taken for granted, and inhales the air, and then looks at this idiot that he's been calling his spiritual guru and says, why in the world are you trying to kill me? What are you doing? And the guy calmly looks at him and says, when you were under the water, what did you want more than anything else? He says, ask me a difficult question, because that one's easy. I wanted air, obviously. And then the old man said, when you want God, when you come to the place where you want God, as much as you wanted air when you were under the water, that's when you'll be in business. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. God says, you'll seek me and you'll find me when you seek me when it's convenient. Mm-mm. When you seek me with all your heart. Now, Marcia and I were talking a little bit about the diligence factor, and worship is a display of diligence, of passion, of acknowledgement that we need him. But we were talking about the rootedness. You talked a little bit about the second point being related to the third point.
Right. I think dependence, understanding our dependence, just as you were talking about our dependence on air, informs our diligence. I think another D in between those two is probably desperation, figuring out, understanding that it doesn't work. It doesn't work without the battery. It doesn't work without Christ and the diligence, the daily. We talked about this a little during our musical worship time of putting God in His rightful place day after day, after moment, after hour, after situation, of putting Him back on His throne, which He's never left. But we have that little piece in us that tends to put other things in the way and try to eschew Him off His throne. But that being diligent about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so, and as you were talking earlier this morning, it was an image came to mind in terms of what we do when we gather here. We're not just going through a polite. This man is passionate about that conductor's baton. He's passionate about you and me together as a community, and as am I, about us coming together, acknowledging that He's enough. But the image came to me of let's take a glass of water. No ice, just a glass of water. It's cool water, and I'm going to offer it to you in two different situations. The first one is at a party. You've just been to the punch bowl about three times, and then I come over and say, hey, here's a glass of water. What are you going to say to me? Probably say, hey, thanks, because you want to be polite. You might even take it. Might take a sip just to not hurt my feelings, but as soon as I'm gone, you're going to put it over on the shelf because you're just kind of being polite to say thank you. Here's the second scenario. I offer you the same glass of water, and you're in a desert, and you've been in that desert for 2 days, and the last 24 hours you have not had a drink of water. I think you'll still say thank you, but it'll be different. There's that religiosity, thank you, that we do it out of politeness. And then there's that we're men and women of the desert. And none of this is water for our soul like Him. You know, in March, as we're talking about embarking on this new season, this chapter of worship, I haven't asked you this in the other services, but Reese comes up with the meaning of the universe, so you can come up with this. But what is it that you yearn for in us as people when we gather together as a community for worship? What are you hoping that we come prepared to do and engaged with? What comes to the top of your mind?
I pray we come expecting to encounter God. I can't imagine.
Not just going through church motions.
No, you can sing songs anytime you want to.
When we gather, we're gathering as a culmination of a week in which we've been in the desert, and each day we were having that privilege of water. But we're also seeing this gathering as a catapult into the following week. There is power when we come together and worship. It's not just, as he said, singing songs. I'm going to ask our worship team to come out, and let's look at the fourth direction, and then we're just going to do it. The fourth expression. There's first direction, then there's dependence, and then there's diligence, but then comes delight. He says, one thing I've asked from the Lord, and that only shall I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. That's not just church. That's in the realm of His presence every day, all the days of my life. And then he says, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple, to gaze on the beauty of that glass of water that my life depends upon, and to seek Him in His temple, to say, we need You. We need You desperately. Exodus chapter 15, verse 11. Who is like You, majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders? In Your unfailing love, You will lead the people You've redeemed. In Your strength, You will guide them to Your holy dwelling. You're awesome in glory. He says, one thing I've asked of the Lord that I shall seek, and he says, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord. The word beauty there, literally in Hebrew, really entails delightfulness. And to seek Him in His temple, you could also translate it inquire. It's going both ways. It's speaking His worth to Him of who He is and what He does. Eugene Peterson says this.
I don't know where you are, but we're not here just to punch a card. We're here to engage with the God of wonders, who is more than enough. He says, the gospel message says you don't live in a mechanistic world ruled by necessity. You don't live in a random world ruled by chance. You live in a world ruled by the God of Exodus and Easter, and he will do things in you that neither you nor your friends would have supposed possible. So right now in the midst of the desert of your journey, would you stand and let's acknowledge with a sense of direction as well as dependence, but also diligently, intensely, passionately, let's delight in the fact that he's enough. Jesus, as we sing this final psalm, may it not just be singing a song in politeness. May it be proclaiming something musically as men and women of the desert who've come across the oasis for our ultimate need. Enable us to get a glimpse, to engage with the fact that you are enough from whatever we got going on in our life that's been worrying us and upsetting us and distracting us. May we together as your people say one thing. We're going to ask of the Lord, and that's what we're together going to seek. We want to gaze on your beauty. To gaze on your enoughness, to gaze on your truth, to gaze on your life and your grace. Hear us right now.
But Jesus, you know what we're all dealing with. You know what's on the floor of our lives, all the things that distract us and worry us and upset us. As we embark on this season with this worship team, the season of acknowledging your worth together, Holy Spirit, would you come, breathe into us as we exalt you and as we engage with who you are and what you're up to. We pray this in the name of the one that we most need. Amen. Amen. So glad you've been here. Some of you need to pray with someone. Maybe you've got a particular need. There'll be folks lined up here and also back in the prayer room. Make sure you say, hey, could you pray with me? We would be delighted to do that. And if you want to just find out more about who we are, about engaging with your gifts, with your abilities, with your finances, with your time, just find somebody with an orange lanyard. Maybe you want to get involved with Belong and Grow coming down. Then do that. You can find somebody with an orange lanyard out there as well as they are milling about and just say, hey, pop a question to them. Then over here, you've got your sugar high. That's where you'll be. Arlene, I'll be heading over there as well. All the different health foods that the halls like will be located back there. Yours is carrot cake, right? Carrot cake cupcake. There you go. So. But they will be back there. You can also get a bite to eat over here at our artisan's kitchen and just linger a bit. Let me tell you about a couple of things coming up. First, tonight at 6:30 is Loyal Worship Night over in the rink. So we get to do what we've been doing here. And Kaylee and Ryan Simpson will be leading us with their band. Actually, Sydney is in their band, so... That's all you got. You just got a wave. All righty. So she did that in the first service and scared me to death. So that's 6:30 tonight. Then let me tell you, these next couple of weeks, one of the things that we are doing here at Northland is wanting to adopt a teaching team. It's not just me. And these next couple of weeks, Arlene and I, the last number of years, in the fall, every year, teach at a Bible Institute in Austria, and we're going as extensions of Northland. Extensions of you. Actually, we'll be unpacking. I'll be teaching about the ABCs of being fully alive, the life of the gospel. So appreciate your prayer for that while we're there. Next week, Pastor Sean will be continuing this series talking about being sent. 2 weeks from today, Steve Brown will be back. He has been here... many years ago, and he is looking forward. He'll be talking about stress relief. He says, I know stress well. I don't know if I know about relief well, but I'll figure it out by the time I preach. You can just hear Steve telling us that. Then the following week, I'll be back, and we'll conclude this series on Calibrate, dive into Awaken, our series in the Gospel of John, for a few weeks before Advent comes. So lots happening. Looking forward to these coming days. Would you open your palms? You know what you most need. Would you receive Him, His grace, His truth, His life, and then go give it away in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.